Welcome, everyone. I hope you're all having a good day so far. Thanks for joining us on today's webinar. Hopefully you've had a chance to attend some other Presto Geosystems webinars over the last year or so. So today we're going to focus on ways to build recreational trails for walking, horse riding, and light vehicle use, as well as different methods for stabilizing embankments near trails. I'm your host, Corey Schneider. I'm a business development manager with Presto Geosystems. I've been with Presto for 14 years, providing technical assistance and site support for our entire product line. We're located in Wisconsin and manufacture erosion control, stormwater management, and porous pavement products that are used all over the US and the world. We sell through an experienced distribution network that can provide local assistance on all of your projects. I have everyone muted now, so if you have any questions during the presentation, please type them in the question window and I will address them all at the end. Here are the things I hope you get out of today's presentation. Hopefully you'll understand how to properly build trails to reduce the impact to the surroundings, how different trail uses can affect the design, how to build through wetlands or other environmentally sensitive areas, and which products are most applicable for unique conditions that may be encountered. We are also going to touch on wall and slope design to ensure that embankments along trails remain stable. First, a little background on Presto. We worked with the Army Corps of Engineers to develop geocell technology in the late 70s, and we have been innovating ever since. Our products have been used in over 200 countries and in every state in the US. And we do pride ourselves in going beyond simply providing a product to you. We've got a lot of design and construction resources available on our website. And of course, you can always reach out to us directly. We do have several experienced engineers on staff, and we offer free project design evaluations. We can also provide contractors with installation support to make sure that the product is not only getting installed correctly, but also as efficiently as possible. And as I mentioned, we do have that local distribution network that can provide local support for your projects from very initial project site walkovers to determine what products might be suitable all the way through installation support. So we basically operate in three product areas. Soil stabilization using our GeoWeb geocells, which can be used for load support, slope and channel protection, as well as constructing green retaining walls. Porous pavements, of which we have both vegetated and aggregate solutions, and lightweight reusable construction mats. Today, we will cover some of our GeoWeb solutions, as well as our aggregate porous pavement product, and a few of our construction mats. An important thing to keep in mind as we go through this webinar: the trails that are made with our products are all considered permeable trails. That is, there is no impermeable paved surface being placed. The final surface is going to be a stone or sand material. This lessens the environmental impact of the trail, reduces the amount of heavy equipment required for installation, often in difficult to reach locations, and it improves the overall cost and speed of the project. We'll begin with what makes a good trail. The first aspect of the design is the reinforcement of the trail area. Especially when the trail moves through sensitive areas, keeping the path intact is how you keep people away from damaging vegetation or getting lost while wandering. The trail needs to be clearly delineated and needs to be reinforced enough to stay in place over time. using products specially designed to act as the reinforcement of the soil or stone means the trail will last longer and will not encroach on the surrounding environment. The next key to a well-designed trail is drainage. Ponding water can ruin a trail surface, and water that runs off the trail into unreinforced areas can scour and damage those areas. As I mentioned, all the products from Presto are considered permeable, and it is precisely for this reason. By keeping the surface permeable, the water infiltrates at the point of contact right when it hits the trail. The water can then permeate down through the product and into the subgrade, entering the groundwater system. The water won't pond at the surface, and it won't run off or collect outside the reinforced areas. This keeps the trail in the same condition, no matter the weather, so there won't be any flaws or failures created below the surface that you can't see. The last thing to consider when designing a trail is how to confine the surface. Loose aggregate, stone, or sand is easily moved under shoes, hooves, tires, and water, leading to ruts, holes, and a generally damaged trail area. When the trail surface is damaged, people are going to want to move around the damage, leading them off the trail and into unprotected areas, potentially disturbing sensitive environments. Keeping the surface in place is an important feature of the products from Presto. When the stone or sand is properly held in place, ruts cannot form and the material can't be washed away. This greatly reduces the amount of maintenance required because the trail surfaces aren't degrading. The first product we'll look at is the GeoWeb three-dimensional soil confinement system. This is a geocell, which may be a term you have heard before. It is similar to a geogrid, but is three-dimensional, so it has depth to provide true confinement and can be used in a wider variety of applications. The GeoWeb system consists of two main components, the cell size and the cell depth. The cells come in three sizes, approximately 8 by 10 inch openings, 11 by 12 inch opening, and 18 by 20 inch opening, and cell heights of 3, 4, 6, 8, and 12 inches. The combination of cell size and depth depend on the project details and loading requirements, but generally trails will use a 4 or 6 inch depth and a small or medium sized cell. The seam strength is very important to the function of a geocell. The stronger the seam strength, the better designed the geocell is. A stronger seam allows for heavier infill material, steeper and taller slopes, and better lifetime performance. The strength of the panel material, in our case, high-density polyethylene, is also critical to the strength and performance of a geocell system. Here you can see a typical GeoWeb panel. It comes tri-folded and palletized. Each section has a nominal width of 8.5 feet with lengths up to 58 feet. The panels are flexible, opening like an accordion, so they can follow the natural contours of the worksite without being confined to a rigid set of dimensions. Here you can see our standard performance and material specification summary. As you can see, there is a lot of information packed into our standard spec sheet. We don't have time to go through everything line by line, but I at least wanted to provide you with a sense of what a typical geocell product spec should look like. You'll note that it contains a lot of detail on key material properties, including weld strength and environmental stress crack resistance, or ESCR. And just a general note, when reviewing product spec sheets for geocells and any geosynthetic product for that matter, you will want to pay close attention to any disclaimer language a product provider tries to sneak into the fine print, usually at the bottom of the page. Recently, we've noticed a concerning trend where low-end product providers present performance data that appears to equal industry accepted standards on the surface, but then they add disclaimer language in the fine print at the bottom stating that their specifications are subject to subject to change without notice, or the information shown is for general purposes and not intended for design. So it's just a heads up to watch out for this type of trap, especially if you get hit with a request from a contractor on one of your projects to evaluate a substitute product. Our spec sheet contains no disclaimers, and we stand behind our numbers, so you can deliver certainty in the solution as you build with materials you can trust. The GeoWeb system, again, is a three-dimensional cellular confinement system, meaning that the GeoWeb panels have individual cells that are filled with an infill material that ultimately makes the final surface of the trail. By confining the infill material, the system distributes the loads and prevents rotting, and the cells keep the infill in place so that it doesn't wash away from stormwater runoff or move with traffic. The surface of the trail is going to be stable no matter what infill is chosen, and require very minimal maintenance for the lifetime of the project. Let's look at some different options for building stable trails with the GeoWeb system. Walk, run, cycle trails are meant for people, small animals such as dogs, and bicycles only. This type of trail is not meant for equestrian use. These are the most common type of trails and can go along shorelines, through urban areas, or through forests or parks. The flexibility of the GeoWeb panels allows for smooth, natural-looking curves. The panels can be held open with stakes, as shown here, but those stakes are generally not permanent. They can be removed once the panels are fully filled. The panels can be laid either along the length or width of the trail. They are easily field cut with a saw or landscape shears and are securely attached together. No matter the dimensions, there will be little waste as panels can be pieced together in nearly any configuration. This is the finished trail surface using a local granite aggregate and allowing vegetation on both sides of the trail. The trail is clearly delineated and meets up with existing paved trails in the distance. The GeoWeb panels will keep the trail in place and level, minimizing surface erosion and potential runoff of contaminants into the adjacent water. This path used granite, as I mentioned, but any type of stone is going to be acceptable as infill material, with the only limitations being that it should be angular rather than rounded for better lockup and have a maximum particle size of about 1/3 the cell depth. So you can use what is local to your area without needing to truck in expensive engineered rock. As I said, it's easy to field cut the GeoWeb panels to accommodate the trail dimensions, even rather narrow trails like this one between a road and a protected wetland. By having the GeoWeb panels create the trail, water runoff from the road won't wash dirt into the wetlands because the water will be able to infiltrate through the permeable GeoWeb surface, keeping the dirt surface in place for a nice jogging path. Paths through neighborhoods or urban areas can augment or replace traditional sidewalks in places where drainage is a concern. Replacing broken and ugly concrete sidewalks with gravel surface paths allows for flexibility in design and aesthetic and will improve the safety of the walkway for pedestrians. These types of trails are good for any typical sidewalk traffic, but can also be designed to support cars or trucks. A 3 to 4 man crew can install about 1,500 square feet of GeoWeb panels per hour, including laying a geotextile fabric and infilling the panels. The geotextile helps to create a separation layer between the natural subgrade and the infill material, and is especially important in areas of very soft subgrade, such as wet clay. The flexible nature of the GeoWeb panels allows it to conform to hills and dips in the paths and allows the system to be pitched to one side if needed. Because GeoWeb gives additional strength to the infill material through confinement, cross sections can be cut in half or more, reducing excavation, aggregate, and maintenance costs. We recommend overfilling the geoweb panels slightly when installing so that there is a wear surface over the panels and the plastic is not visible. This surface will become naturally compacted over time based on the trail usage. Having the panels slightly overfilled helps protect the geoweb material from vehicle tires or other potential damage. Equestrian trails are next, and they have some different requirements than walking paths. Equestrian trails have to be hardy enough to stand up to horseshoes while remaining smooth enough to avoid damage to the horse's hooves. Horseshoes can pick up a surprising amount of dirt with each step, and with their heavy concentrated point loading can cause fast deterioration of the trail. If the trail is designed to withstand horse traffic, it will be more than sufficient to handle hiking, biking, and small motorized vehicles. A geoweb trail system was utilized for erosion control for the equestrian trails we see here. The gravel surface is resistant to rutting and the 1-inch stone size is easy for the horses to walk over. This aggregate path will not get muddy or create sinkholes, so the surface will remain ready for use even after rain or heavy use. Having a well-defined path also helps prevent damage to areas off of the trail, and using the geoweb system allows for the inclusion of natural markers, such as the large boulders we see here, on both sides of the system. Now we are going to walk through a case study for a shoreline trail in The Colony, Texas. This project was a multi-use trail along the shoreline of a lake. The trail will see pedestrians, bikes, small vehicles, and potentially equestrian traffic. The client, the city of The Colony, wanted to follow the natural contours of the shoreline, which the flexible geoweb panels can easily handle. There was a concern about the potential for uplift under the system due to the very high water table and lake level fluctuations, so additional steps were taken to prevent this from occurring. A series of polyester tendons were run through the geoweb panels and were anchored multiple times per panel. The tendons, in conjunction with the final infill stone material, prevents the geoweb system from lifting and deforming due to groundwater pressures. This is good practice in wet environments with potentially saturated soils. A well-graded decomposed granite was chosen as the infill material as it was readily available in the area. Using local materials is encouraged, though any type of stone is acceptable as long as it is angular and allows good drainage. This means that you're going to want stone with limited fines so that water can percolate through the system. If the water can't infiltrate, you will get ponding at the surface, similar to a paved surface such as asphalt. So you want to make sure your infill material avoids this problem. And you should keep in mind that this material is going to be your final surface, so aesthetics may be a factor in choosing the material. Once the geoweb panels were installed, the infill was placed with a standard front end loader and then raked by hand to ensure all the cells were fully filled. The material should be placed on the outside of the panels as needed to match the final grade and meet up with the unexcavated areas. For ease of construction, you can drive your vehicles and equipment on the geoweb panels as soon as they are filled, right up to the limits of the filled area if necessary, so you don't have to wait for the entire system to be filled before using it. This can help minimize the impact of construction on the area, since you won't need to create access lanes or clear out excess vegetation on the sides. A small smooth-barreled roller compactor finishes off the job. This is where having the wearing surface of overfilled material mentioned earlier comes into play. The compactor isn't driving directly on the geoweb panels, and you can easily visually confirm that no cell is underfilled. Again, the stone infill should have minimal fines. Less than 10% is ideal. Avoiding fines in your stone allows the system to stay permeable and not get clogged. Trails built with the GeoWeb system are a great example of green infrastructure by not disrupting the water cycle or impacting the groundwater flow. No additional stormwater infrastructure is needed when the trail surface is permeable, so there is minimal impact on the environment around the trail. Here we can see the nice clean trail created using GeoWeb, allowing for most uses without having to worry about needing constant maintenance. The path is clearly delineated while maintaining a natural look that people won't mind seeing in their backyards. A few months after the installation, there was a large rainfall event, over 7 inches of rain in a 3-hour period, which can be incredibly damaging both during and after the storm. Several portions of the trail were flooded to the point of standing water at the surface on and around the GeoWeb protected area. But thanks to the GeoWeb system and the extra precautions such as the tendon system, the trail was not washed away as you might expect from an unprotected gravel trail. It was still usable, allowing maintenance workers access to the damaged areas for inspection and repair. No repair was needed to the GeoWeb system, and once the water was able to infiltrate, the trail was as good as new. When there is such a large rainfall event, the ground becomes saturated and doesn't allow water to infiltrate, giving it no choice but to stay at the surface and become sheet runoff. The GeoWeb system protects the trail surface against erosion when this happens, with the cell walls functioning as a series of check dams, keeping the infill confined within the individual cells. Then, when it is able, the water can infiltrate into the ground and the trail is still in good shape. Now, moving away from the GeoWeb system, the next option we'll illustrate has a similar confinement of infill, but within a rigid paver structure, and this is our GeoPave gravel paver system. Unlike the GeoWeb material, which is typically 4 or 6 inches deep for trails, GeoPave units are just 2 inches deep and made from recycled high-density polyethylene. The GeoPave units have the rigid paver characteristics that you can see here, with specific features needed for performance with aggregate infill. The main one I want to highlight is the monolithic mesh bottom. This is a molded in place mesh on the underside of the paver unit. This mesh keeps the stone infill from migrating under the unit, and the integrated nature assists in the overall rigidity of the paver unit. The lattice bottom spreads the load similar to a snowshoe, so the wheel loads do not create ruts. GeoPave units are locked together with a connection device to create a fully integrated, contiguous pavement that is highly resistant to traffic stresses. GeoPave was designed using a finite element analysis and will not lift up over time, as you might see with other systems. As I mentioned, the GeoPave unit is only 2 inches deep, which can be a real asset if the project requires a thin cross section due to buried utilities or high excavation costs. We'll now look at a few project examples. The one we're showing here is an access trail for walking down to a swimming area on a lake. The walkway had to be ADA compliant so that everyone could use it. It was also important that the trail help reduce runoff into the lake, so the permeable nature of the GeoPave system was critical. You can see the eroded trail before stabilization, both the trail surface and the surrounding areas, and the new trail area on the right stabilized with GeoPave. The protected system will help prevent erosion from stormwater runoff and be a smoother surface for walking on for visitors. Here's another trail. This one's in a wetlands area. And in this case, the geopave units were placed directly on the subgrade. It was a sandy subgrade, so it infiltrated quite well. And so we didn't use a geotextile separation fabric or the base layer of aggregate in this case, but they can be incorporated to support heavier loads or if you need additional stormwater detention. No matter the section, the entire system creates a flat, stable surface and supports the anticipated loads. The same principles that we discussed with the GeoWeb system apply here as well. By using an open graded aggregate stone with minimal fines content, the water can infiltrate at the point of contact, reducing surface runoff, and the individual cells can find the aggregate, preventing rutting and washout of the stone for a stable walking surface. A major concern here was protecting sensitive tree roots from impact damage. The geopave units are a great way to provide tree root protection by creating a bridge over the roots. So there is no direct contact from vehicle or pedestrian loads that could harm the trees. This bridge lasts the lifetime of the geopave trail and allows the trees to grow unimpeded. One of the great things about building trails with the GeoWeb or geopave system is the amount of choice you have over the final look of the system. Two rock colors were chosen at this site to delineate the parking from the walkways. A light colored crushed limestone was used for the parking areas, and a contrasting reddish-brown buckshot aggregate for the walkways. Additional delineation, such as concrete parking stops or snap delineators, can also be included to help create a sense of separation within the overall geopave system. This project ultimately earned LEED Gold for all of the low-impact structure and landscape elements. Protecting the local watershed was the primary reason for the inclusion of permeable parking and walkways utilizing the geopave system. These pavements also perform as natural on-site stormwater detention, storing water in the base for natural percolation without the need for a large isolated detention pond, which would have been an unattractive nuisance on-site. The geopave units come in 20 by 40 inch panels covering about 5.4 square feet, but they can easily be field cut or staggered to accommodate curves, so you're definitely not locked into a linear path with the geopave. The system was a great choice for this project with a quick and easy installation, the ability to allow water to flow through the system and not run off into the pond, and providing a smooth, clean surface for walking. So while the standard geopave units are black, we do have a tan option available that can allow for natural blending with a light colored stone. Again, the options available for the final design of the trails are what make using the system so versatile and a great choice for any job. The last option for trail surfaces is the GeoTerra system, which are construction mats that are strong yet lightweight and don't require any fill. Because no fill is required, they are perfect for areas where infill resources are scarce. Because there is no infill, the GeoTerra trails won't kill the existing vegetation they are placed over. They are open on the top and bottom and allow for vegetation to grow through them as long as they are in place, which is essential for minimizing environmental impacts for trails. GeoTerra units cover approximately 5 square feet each and can be connected to cover a larger area as needed. The mats are strong enough to support heavy vehicle and construction traffic loads, and have enough flexural strength to bridge soft soils without warping or cracking. The units are connected with a strong metal connector to essentially form a floating road through wetlands with very soft soils. The connected mat system distributes loading across the pavement, minimizing potential for rutting or sinking in soft, muddy soils. In some areas of Alaska, hundreds of miles of ATV trails cut across wetlands and stream beds, causing extensive damage to natural preserves. ATV riders can cause the loss of vegetated cover and habitat values. Geoterra mats offer a great solution for low impact access in these wet and environmentally sensitive areas. The preferred method is to place the units across the entire trail width, but in some cases, just in the wheel paths is acceptable, as you can see on the far right. As planned, indigenous grasses regenerated through the permeable open-celled Geoterra mats, ultimately semi-camouflaging the product with the natural environment and protecting the vegetation from damage. In this case, the system ultimately ended up as a permanent structure, and the Geoterra mats will last for as long as they are needed. So the last section, we're going to pivot from the flat surface of the trail to the embankments that may be alongside or near the trail. Green walls can help create the space for trails to run through and work with permeable trails to allow water flow and promote vegetation. The same GeoWeb GeoCell technology that creates the trail surface can also be adapted to create retaining walls, such as this vegetated levee. The GeoWeb panels are stacked vertically on top of one another to create the wall, allowing for more horizontal space for the trail to be placed. The primary benefit of the GeoWeb wall is to create a stable, natural, living structure with vegetation for aesthetic appeal. The open front fascia allows rainwater to infiltrate, and the wall structure can also absorb some runoff from the top of the wall, such as from walking trails that may be nearby. While vegetated walls are most common, aggregate-filled walls are also possible. Using the same open-graded aggregate we have been talking about, water can infiltrate through the wall so there isn't runoff onto your road or trail. An aggregate wall may be useful when you don't want to worry about maintaining vegetation in an area, such as an emergency response space, or in areas where vegetation is difficult to establish. The walls are designed as either gravity or reinforced walls in the same way as mechanically stabilized earth or MSE wall systems. An advantage they have over MSE block walls is flexibility in poor soil conditions. Their relatively lightweight and flexible nature allows them to tolerate reasonable differential settlement very well. Another advantage over traditional walls, such as gabion baskets, is the relatively shallow embedment depth of the wall and the ability to create a very steep wall face, as steep as 80 degrees. Walls can be built in channels with limited space, such as through neighborhoods, without the need for heavy unloading delivery vehicles. The steep side slopes of the channel mean that the horizontal footprint is much smaller than if the side slopes needed to be shallower. The small required construction footprint is generally well received by residents of neighborhood projects. It's always necessary to consider live and dead loads that the wall will experience, especially when placed near trails or roadways. Dead loads can be buildings or soil slopes above the wall. Live loads are typically construction traffic and long-term vehicle traffic. When possible, the loads should be placed away from the edge of the wall or fascia. But if that's not possible, the design will need to be robust enough to support and withstand the live and dead loads. Having traffic barriers at the top of the wall, such as this wooden fence, will help keep the loads away from the GeoWeb system, which can help with the design and allow you to build a less expensive wall. We'll now look at a vegetated retaining wall case study. Here was a project that was faced with having to retain soils in a very problematic soft soil area. Piling systems were expensive and they wanted to maintain the natural environment. Concrete and modular block walls were also considered, but ultimately they chose the vegetated geocell wall for its natural aesthetics and lower cost. Here you can see the wall structure is constructed with a slight setback to allow for topsoil infill and vegetation in the front face. The backfill material is a good drainable aggregate. The wall can be seeded either by mixing the seeds in the soil before installation or by hydroseeding or broadcasting once installation is complete. As mentioned, the system's inherent ability to withstand some differential settlement in soft soil environments was extremely important at this site. The wall had varying heights along its length, which was also easily accommodated by the geocell system. By using the geocell wall, they didn't have to bring in invasive equipment such as augers or H-piles, speeding the installation process. Here's the completely vegetated wall. The horizontal terraces allow rainwater collection, helping to minimize runoff and erosion. Pretty much any type of grass or flowering vegetation will survive on these walls. So by using local vegetation, upkeep can be kept to a minimum. Presto offers a free software for designing geoweb retaining walls and slopes. It's available on our website, which is prestogeo.com, and can be used by engineers and designers to determine if the geoweb system is appropriate for your projects. There are a lot of resources on the website on how to use and interpret the software, but our engineering team is always happy to help with any questions or recommendations. So far, we've looked at trail surface construction and vegetated retaining walls. Geoweb can also be used for erosion protection in a surficial manner. This is a good way to protect slopes against erosion when the slope is shallower than what would be required for a retaining wall and globally stable. Generally, we do the surficial protection at 60 degrees or shallower. Again, as long as your slope is globally stable. If there are questions about this type of application, we're happy to talk through it. There are basically three main types of infill that we can use for slopes, depending on the type of protection needed. Topsoil with vegetation is certainly the most popular. Next would be aggregates, and those are typically used in areas where vegetation is hard to establish. And then you can also infill with concrete. That's usually only used in the very harshest of conditions, though. So we'll focus on the topsoil vegetation as it is typically what is selected in trail applications to keep the trail looking as natural as possible. Here's a simplified diagram showing how the different components interact with the geoweb to form a complete system. We'll talk about each component next. To begin, you've got your slope with some standard dimensions, slope length, slope angle. Generally, the first thing that will go down is a geosynthetic layer. This can be a geotextile, geomembrane, or geogrid. These aren't always required, and we typically try to stay away from them in vegetated applications. But we can definitely make recommendations on whether any geosynthetic is needed below the system based on project details. Then the geoweb is put in place. Note how the geoweb has a horizontal turn near the top of the slope. This is important for crest anchorage and erosion control because we want to prevent any water from getting underneath the system. And then we have two options for anchoring. The simplest one is using stake anchors. So these are placed mid-slope and at the crest, with the number and spacing of the stakes being project dependent. The other option is to use the tendons that we showed on that Texas Trail project. These are typically tied off to a dead man pipe that's buried at the crest. Or if we don't have room for a trench at the crest of the slope, we can tie these off to earth or rock anchors at the crest as well. The geoweb is then filled with the desired infill material, and if vegetated, an erosion control blanket or hydro seeding is typically used to prevent any washout prior to the vegetation becoming established. So the atrachee is the first component for a completely integrated system. We use this to connect individual panels of geoweb into a single web that covers the entire slope. It's going to allow for faster installation of the geoweb and will last the lifetime of the project, ensuring that the slope is protected and that the geoweb system will not fail under anticipated loads. The specific engineering values of the atrachee will ensure the system holds up to loading over time without the corrosion seen in staples, which is kind of the old way of connecting sections together, or the failure of underperforming cable ties, which are not really an engineered system. As slope angle increases, the driving force of the infill material exceeds the available frictional resisting force, and additional anchorage is required. So Atra anchors, which are just plastic Atra clips that fit on top of a number 4 rebar, hold the geoweb to the slope and penetrate into the ground. If corrosion resistance is required due to project conditions, we do have a high density polyethylene Atra speed stake that is designed to work specifically with the geoweb product. For long steep slopes, slopes where the native soil is highly erodible or over a surface that cannot be punctured, such as a geomembrane, tendons can be used. The Atra tendon clips transfer the load from heavy infill material to the tendons and then to the crest anchorage system. Only the Atra tendon clip is specifically designed to fully transfer safely and securely the forces placed upon the geocell. Every accessory and every feature has been designed and tested to specifically work together so that we go from problem to design to construction solution with a system where the modeling replicates the real world forces. Now we'll take a very quick look at a couple of slope protection projects associated with trails. The American Tobacco Trail is a 20-mile rails to trails project running from Durham County to Chatham County in North Carolina. This slope had to be reconstructed after it was excavated in conjunction with the replacement of a culvert. After the culvert was replaced, the slope was regraded to its original 1.3:1 slope angle, and it needed to be revegetated. The geoweb slope protection system proved to be the perfect solution here. And you can see on this photo on the left that we did use the tendon system. So before they put the infill in, this tendon will be tied off to either earth anchors or a PVC pipe, which will be buried. Another great example of using geoweb for slope protection here is a trail. It's the Lance Armstrong Bikeway in downtown Austin, Texas. So they used the geoweb in the areas that they did not want a hard surface slope protection and planted it with small plants that will grow up over time. In summary, Presto Geosystems offers geoweb, geopave, and geoterra that can meet any trail design needs, as well as geoweb for earth retention and slope protection near trails. Each product is designed to protect the surrounding environment while offering a low maintenance surface that won't wash away during heavy rain events. We offer a complete solution, including connections and anchoring options. And another part of our complete solution is our technical assistance. We provide free project design evaluations. So you can get the proper forms off of our website, which is again, prestogeo.com. And then this button right here near the top in the middle, free project evaluation. So you just fill that out with as much information as you have. And it also gives you the ability to attach documents such as geotechnical reports or site plans. Then our engineering department will get it. And within 3 business days, but usually faster, we provide a complete design evaluation, including infill recommendations and anchorage requirements. We'll work with you to get you the best design for your project. So we certainly don't mind doing a few iterations just to make sure that we get you a solution that's going to work for your project. We're now making it faster and easier for you to obtain your PDH certificates. We've got a new webinar dashboard that allows you to easily view our webinars and download PDH certificates for both on-demand and live webinars attended. Your webinar dashboard will keep a record of all webinars attended, along with PDH credits earned. A link with more information and instructional videos will be emailed to you within the next couple of days. Those of you who are in attendance today will automatically receive a PDH certificate within the next 24 hours. Note that this will come from GoToWebinar and not from Presto. So you may think it's junk, but take a quick look at it before deleting it. So here's my contact information. I want to thank you for attending and remind you that you can send questions to us at any time at info@prestogeo.com, or you can send them directly to me at corey.schneider@prestogeo.com that you see here. You can go to prestogeo.com for a wealth of information, and don't forget to view our YouTube videos found by clicking on the YouTube icon in the upper right-hand corner of our webpage. So I'm going to go to answer the questions next, but if you do have questions that I don't get to before you have to leave, or if you think of a question later, again, you can respond to the follow-up email you'll be getting. You can send questions to info@prestogeo.com or email me directly. So now to the questions. I'm going to scroll up here and start at the beginning. First one is, what is the life of HDPE or high density polyethylene? We've done accelerated lab testing, so UV is what's going to break down HDPE, if anything, and we have UV inhibitors in our GeoWeb and GeoPave, as well as the GeoTerra, so they don't even begin to break down for well over 100 years, so they're going to last quite a long time. What is the best product for scour protection repair? Trails that have moderate slope that are prone to washout and rutting from heavy rain. I would definitely recommend that you use the GeoWeb product. It does work a little bit better on these moderate slopes. GeoPave is probably a little more appropriate for flatter installations. So I'd take a look at the GeoWeb in those applications. What is the maximum grade that this material can be used on? I've got a site with a switchback path over 40 feet of vertical slope at 25% grade. So we would do about a 10% grade going down the slope. Yeah, with the GeoWeb, you can, you know, as we saw, you can hang it on one-to-one slopes. So GeoWeb really doesn't have an effective limit on maximum grade. With the GeoPave, I would say around 10% is probably about as steep as you want to go. What are the surface prep requirements for Geocell? You just want to smooth out that existing subgrade as much as you can. Really no other requirements. We are generally trying to infiltrate ground or infiltrate water, so we really don't want to do any excessive compaction. Just smooth it out as much as is feasible. Cost per square foot for a typical trail? Well, I would say, if we assume we're going to use our mid-size cell 4 inches deep, which is pretty typical for a trail, the geoweb and the geotextile material, you're probably looking at, we'll call it $1 a square foot on the top end. That, of course, does not include the installation or the infill that you would use. One of the major issues with stone or a natural surface is erosion, particularly on slopes. How does this system address this problem? I think we kind of covered that, basically confining that stone. The cell walls act as check dams, so there's really no way for it to wash out. Does the stone overlay need to be compacted for stability? Yeah, we do want to put a lightweight roller compactor at a minimum on these surfaces once they're infilled. Does the geoweb material degrade over time and require replacement? We pretty much covered that with the 100-year life. Do we recommend a filter fabric below the geoweb to prevent fine migration? Yes, we definitely do. Especially with an aggregate surface, we certainly want that separation. Define fines. We typically think of fines as anything that goes through the number 200 sieve. To comply with ADA, a blend of smaller aggregates are required. That has meant that in Pennsylvania, a graded stone that includes a small percentage of fines is required. What will that do to the geoweb system? It won't do anything with it. The only reason we recommend little to no fines is for permeability. It does not affect the functioning of the geoweb. If you have a lot or a little fines, it's just going to slightly limit the permeability with the more fines you have. What type of traffic does require frequent maintenance? Heavy bike or horse, ATV, snowmobile? It really depends. Basically, by confining this material in either geoweb or geopave, you're going to reduce the amount of maintenance that you have, but maintenance may still be necessary, but again, it's going to depend on how frequent the use is, what types of speeds these vehicles are traveling at, what sort of grades they're on. So it can vary, but yes, the traffic that you mentioned with horse and ATV and snowmobile all can typically require a little bit of maintenance. How permeable is the geoweb horizontally? It's got about a 25% opening in the cell walls, so it's reasonably permeable in the horizontal. It seems that over time, trails will become filled with fines from the environment, which will reduce the infiltration rate. Is there any kind of data on longevity of infiltration or decreased infiltration rates? There's so many variables involved in that no, I don't have long-term data. We do have parking lots and trails that have been in the ground for 20 years that are not clogged. But again, the environment where the installation takes place is going to have a large effect on if these systems will clog over time. Can infiltration rates be restored? You can try to do some light suction, that will take fines out, but not the stone infill. If that doesn't work, the other option would be to replace the stone, or you could attempt to hose out the entire system to wash some of those fines out. Can the geoweb be recycled if needed to, when it's removed? Yes, it can. It's high-density polyethylene, so a recycling center should be able to handle that. Base prep requirements for geopave, depending on the subgrade strength and the maximum loading, you would need anywhere from 0 to 6 inches of clean crushed rock for the base. And just like the geoweb, you just want to get your subgrade as smooth as possible. Try to avoid a whole lot of compaction if you're planning to infiltrate. And that's really all you got to do. One GeoTerra picture showed a mesh installed under the GeoTerra. Is this mandatory? What is the purpose? I believe that was a geogrid, so that could be used if you still want to attempt to get vegetation to grow up through it, but if you do want additional structural strength. And no, it's not required. It really depends on site conditions. How often do you recommend tiebacks? I'm thinking that's in the retaining wall section. So yeah, if it's an MSE structure, they're typically going to be every 2 feet vertically. How can you find the local representative for a project evaluation? Oh, I see that one was answered by one of my teammates. What type of pipe is used to anchor the tendons? Generally just a schedule 80 PVC pipe. And is it filled with concrete? No, doesn't need to be filled with concrete. But yes, the backfill is compacted. For a geoweb system in which guardrail posts need to be driven through the system, what construction practices should be used? You're actually going to want to install sonnet tubes and basically build the geoweb wall around them. Or if you're only installing them a couple of feet deep, you can probably drive them through the center of a cell. But what you do want to avoid, of course, is augering into the system, because that's not gonna work too well. If you catch that auger on the geoweb panels, you could destroy the whole system. Do you have experience with geoweb trails for ATV trails like U.S. Forest Service? Concerned about rutting on corners? I think the GeoTerra would not be acceptable because it's too visible. We've done some Forest Service trails, ATV type trails. And yeah, I mean, as I've kind of mentioned before, ATVs can be pretty harsh on whatever trail surface you are constructing. You shouldn't really see too much rutting. If there's a lot of quick acceleration, you could get some emptying of the cells. So you may need to keep an eye on those areas and potentially top dress occasionally. Are these state DEP approved, particularly the channel liners? As I mentioned, we developed the technology with the Army Corps of Engineers. So, you know, the Corps approves the geoweb and channels. I guess I can't say 100% sure that all 50 state DEPs approve them, but certainly the vast majority do. Does HDPE leach chemicals into the soil, water, environment? Nope, there's no leaching from HDPE at all. What's an inexpensive stake material for staking down the rope threaded through the geoweb and soft ground? Typically just a rebar. You could use a rebar with one of our Atra-Stake clips on top of it, or you could have a rebar with a J on the end, which we call a J hook. So kind of looks like a candy cane, and you can put that over the top of the tendon. Presto is a PennDOT Bulletin 15 supplier. Project examples. Kyle, I could send you some project examples if you just want to shoot me a quick email. We can definitely get you some of those. Will this product float in a wetland area that periodically floods? Not sure which product. All of these have a specific gravity that is very close to one. So they won't automatically float. They won't sink either. So we definitely would look at anchoring any one of these HDPE products if it's in an area that floods frequently. Lead production time on the web. Really depends on what type of GeoWeb you're looking at, as well as quantity, but we have hundreds of thousands of square feet in our warehouse at any given time. What infill do I recommend for street bicycle use? I would probably recommend using GeoPave because it is rigid and will be easier for a street bike to ride on than the GeoWeb. So I'd use GeoPave and infill it with a 5/8 inch clean crushed rock. All right, well, that looks like that covers all the questions, and I see we are at 1 hour exactly. So we're gonna end the webinar right now. Again, thanks to all who have attended. And you see my email up there still, so don't hesitate to shoot me an email if any questions come up. Goodbye, everyone, and have a good rest of your day.